Good morning, everyone. What a joy it is to be together. God is so good and so awesome. That's for sure. Well, we want to praise him today that he's our rescuer. And it's wonderful to have someone who rescues us from sin. We are all in need of rescue, but God gave his son, Jesus Christ. So let's stand and sing. He's our rescuer. You remember this song, right? He's our rescuer. Hey! All right. There is good news for the captive, good news for the shame. There's good news for the one who walked away. There is good news for the doubter, the one religion failed. For the good Lord has come to seek and save. He's our rescuer. Hey! He's our rescuer. Hey! We are free from sin forevermore. Oh, how sweet the sound. Hey! Oh, how grace abounds. Hey! We will praise the Lord, our rescuer. He is beauty for the blind man, riches for the poor. He's friendship for the one the world ignores. He is pasture for the weary, rest for those who strive. For the good Lord is the way, the truth and life. Yes, the good Lord is the way, truth and light. He's our rescuer. Hey! He's our rescuer. Hey! We are free from sin forevermore. Oh, how sweet the sound. Hey! Oh, how grace abounds. Hey! We will praise the Lord, our rescuer. Oh, oh, oh. So come and be chainless, come and be fearless, come to the foot of Calvary. There is redemption for every affliction here at the foot of Calvary. So come and be chainless, and be fearless, come to the foot of Calvary. There is redemption for every affliction here at the foot of Calvary. He's our rescuer. Hey! He's our rescuer. Hey! We are free from sin forevermore. Oh, how sweet the sound. Hey! Oh, how grace abounds. Hey! We will praise the Lord, our rescuer. He's our rescuer. Hey! He's our rescuer. Hey! We are free from sin forevermore. Oh, how sweet the sound. Hey! Oh, how grace abounds. Hey! We will praise the Lord, our rescuer. We will praise the Lord, our rescuer.
Brother, since you just walked in, you want to come and open in prayer for us?
Okay. Mm-hmm. Great day to worship the Lord together. Mm-hmm. Let's pray together. Lord, okay. Thank you, Father, as we think of the Lord Jesus Christ, that he is our rescuer. He has delivered us from the bondage and the power of sin. Amen. We thank you for that. Today, Lord, we worship you and commit our time to you together. In Christ's name, amen.
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 Thank you. Brother Bob, he's a pastor in New Jersey. Retired pastor. I always figured that meant retreaded. Well, it's wonderful to have you here with us. Originally from Smithville, but was pastoring in Connecticut, right?
My mom is from Smithville, not myself.
Okay. But you know what Cape Bretoners are? They're like homing pigeons. Even if it was your mom or your grandmom, you still end up coming home. Mm-hmm. That's right. This is a great old hymn with a beautiful truth. In tenderness, he sought me. In tenderness, he sought me, weary and sick with sin. And on his shoulders brought me back to his fold again. While angels in his presence sang until the courts of heaven rang. Oh, the love that sought me, oh, the blood that bought me, oh, the grace that brought me to the fold. Wondrous grace that brought me to the fold. He washed the bleeding sin wound and poured in oil and wine. He whispered to assure me, I found thee, thou art mine. I never heard a sweeter voice, it made my aching heart rejoice. Oh, the love that sought me, oh, the blood that bought me, oh, the grace that brought me to the fold. Wondrous grace that brought me to the fold. He pointed to the nail prints, for me his blood he shed. A mocking crown so thorny was placed upon his head. I wonder what he saw in me to suffer such deep agony. Oh, the love that sought me, oh, the blood that bought me, oh, the grace that brought me to the fold. Wondrous grace that brought me to the fold. I'm sitting in his presence, the sunshine of his face, while with adoring wonder his blessings I retrace. It seems as if eternal days are far too short to sound his praise. Oh, the love that sought me, oh, the blood that bought me, oh, the grace that brought me to the fold. Wondrous grace that brought me to the fold. So while the hours are passing, all now is perfect rest. I'm waiting for the morning, the brightest and the best, when he will call us to his side to be with him, his spotless bride. Oh, the love that sought me, oh, the blood that bought me, oh, the grace that brought me to the fold. Wondrous grace that brought me to the fold. Oh, the love that sought me, oh, the blood that bought me, oh, the grace that brought me to the fold. Wondrous grace that brought me to the fold. You may be seated. Jesus, he gave up everything for you. That's a wonderful truth. Praise God. He gave everything he owned so that we might be owned by him.
You sheltered me from harm. You brought me home. Brought me home. You gave my life to me. You set me free. set me free. Jesus, I praise and worship you. You took my life and made it new. And you gave up everything you owned. Gave up your life, your heart, your home. You gave up everything you owned. Just to bring me back to you. You taught me how to love. What it's of. What it's of. You shed your blood upon the cross for all my sin. And I know the way to go. Nobody else could ever know what you went through to bring me home. And you gave up everything you own. You gave up your life, your heart, your home. You gave up everything you own just to bring me back to you. Jesus, now that we know we are loving you so, and coming in full surrender for your coming someday to take us away, and we'll glorify your name until you come. You gave up everything you owned. You gave up your life, your heart, your home. You gave up everything you own just to bring me back to you. Just to bring me back to you. Just to bring me back to you.
For some of you older people here, you probably recognize this tune, but I couldn't leave the good tune alone. I had to put different lyrics to it. So, but it's wonderful to have a Savior, isn't it? Today we'll be in 1 John chapter 2, verse 1. And that passage gives us, 1 and 2, gives us amazing truth about God and His supreme sacrifice. What a wonderful Savior He is, Man of Sorrows.
Man of Sorrows, what a name. For the Son of God who came. Ruined sinners to reclaim. Ruined sinners to reclaim. Ruined sinners. Ruined sinners to reclaim. To reclaim. Hallelujah. Oh, what a Savior. Bearing shame and scoffing rude. In my place condemned He stood. Seal my pardon with His blood. Seal my pardon. Seal my pardon. Seal my pardon with His blood. Oh, with His blood. Hallelujah. Oh, what a Savior. Oh, guilty, vile, and helpless we. Spotless Lamb of God was He. Full atonement, can it be? Full atonement, can it be? Full atonement, full atonement, can it be? Oh, can it be? Hallelujah. Oh, what a Savior. Lifted up was He to die. It is finished was His cry. Now in heaven, exalted high, now in heaven, exalted high, now in heaven, now in heaven, exalted high, exalted high. Hallelujah. What a Savior. When He comes, our glorious King. Oh, all His ransomed home to bring. Then anew this song will sing. Then anew this song will sing. Then I knew this song will sing. This song will sing. Hallelujah. What a Savior.
Oh, what a wonderful Savior is Jesus Christ our Lord. He is so awesome, so good. We can praise Him all the day long. We could never praise Him enough. Discover His goodness. Well, I think we're going to have a puppet show.
Oh, dear. Oh, dear. What am I going to do? Oh, it's so sad. I got myself in a pickle, not the first time, but, oh my, I don't know what to do. Oh, look who's coming. It's Ollie the Octopus.
Well, hello, lammies. How are you todays?
Well, Ollie, it's good to see you.
Yes, well, I thought I would come for a little visit. Yes.
Well, Lammy, I mean, Ollie, I got a problem.
Oh, do you? Well, that's nothing new for you.
Well, no, that's true, but...
What's the problem, Lammies?
Well, I was wanting to buy something and I really wanted it.
Yes, and so...
Well, it was a big bag of alfalfa, and you also got a special prize with it. It was like a toy, and I was so excited, but I didn't have any money.
Oh, so you didn't buy it because you didn't have the monies, eh?
No, I heard that Bert Bunny was in the banking business.
Oh, I think I know about Bert the Bunny.
Yes, well, he decided he would become a banker. Bart Bunny the banker, he says. And that he told me, he saw me looking in the window at the bag of alfalfa and the prize, and he said, poor Lammy, you can't get it, can you? I said, no, Bart, I don't have any money. Bart told me, it doesn't matter whether you have money or not. I said, I don't understand that. How can it be? He said, I can lend you the money.
Oh, and what did you do?
I said, you can lend me the money? He said, yes, I'll lend you the money. Oh, so I said, well, that sounds like a good deal. You mean I can get the money and I can buy the stuff? Yes, no problem, said Bart Bunny, no problem at all. So I said, well, that's a good deal, don't you think so?
Wells, I don't think so, no. Because you're in trouble now, are you?
Well, yeah, because I got the money from Bart, I bought it, and it cost like $10.
Ooh, that's a lot of monies.
It is, and I was so happy, but then Bart came to see me.
Yes?
And he wants his $10 back.
Yes?
I don't have the $10.
Oh, what are you going to do?
I don't know. He said, well, if you don't have the $10, then I get to get your bag of alfalfa. And he said, because there's interest, I don't know what that means, but anyway, he must be interested in something. He said that I had to give him the toy, and I had to give him a whole other box of things that I have, and some of them are very special to me, but I don't have any choice. I have to pay my debt.
Well, Lammy, I hope you learned a lesson.
I did. I'm not going to borrow any money again. I didn't have anything to pay it back with in the first place. I guess I just wanted to have that so bad.
What are you going to do?
I have to give him an envelope. I have to give him everything. 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 I think he even wants my bed.
Bart Bunny can drive a hard bargain, he can. Well, I don't know what you could do.
Well, baby, I don't know either. What if I went and borrowed some more money?
I think you better not think about that one. Look at the mess you're in now. I tell you what, I'll give you the money.
What? You can't do that. You can't pay for my debt.
I can, and I will, if you've learned your lesson.
Oh, I've learned my lesson. Oh, yes, yes, yes. I will never do anything stupid again.
Well, I don't think that better be a promise. But okay.
But how would you have $10?
Don't you forget that I'm an octopus. And I travel along the bottom of the ocean. And I see shipwrecks. And there's money there.
Oh, are you allowed to have it?
Yes, when it's in the bottom of the ocean, I'm allowed to have it. Besides, it's from hundreds of years ago. And so I have some money.
You're going to give it to me?
I'm going to pay your debt.
So I won't owe Bart Bunny anything?
No, nothing at all.
Oh, Ollie, thank you. You're going to pay all my debt.
I am. Yes, I will.
But why? Why would you do that? You could spend it on yourself.
It's because I love you.
Oh, isn't that wonderful? You love me, and you really do, because you pay for my debts.
Yes, I will get the monies. And we will go and see Bart Bunny and pay him off.
Oh, This is amazing. I'm going to give you a hug. Oh, I forgot how slimy you are. But that's okay. I don't mind being slimed by you.
Wells, I don't mind being dried by you. But I got to get back to the water, and I'll get the money and come back, and I will pay your debt.
Oh, but when will I pay you back?
You don't pay me back. It's a gift.
Oh, that's awesome. Thank you so much, Ollie.
Okay's, I'll be back shortly's. And don't forget that someone paid a bigger debt than this.
Who's that?
Jesus. He paid the debt of your sins. That's far more than the trouble you got in. And he died on the cross to pay for our sins because he loved us so much.
Wow. I understand that better now. Okay, I'll see you soon.
Yes, I'll be back soon. I must get into the waves. Oh, I'm getting dried out.
Oh, my goodness. What a wonderful gift. And I'm so glad for the gift that God gave when he gave his son Jesus and paid for our sins. That's awesome. I gotta go tell Millie, and then I'll come back and meet Ollie. Bye, everybody. Millie, you'll never guess what happened.
This is what the Lord has done. He paid a debt he did not owe. And I owed a debt I couldn't pay. That's good news. He paid a debt he did not owe. I owed a debt I could not pay. I needed someone to wash my sins away. And now I sing a brand new song, Amazing Grace, all day long. Christ Jesus paid a debt that I could never pay. He paid a debt at Calvary. He cleansed my soul and made me free. I'm glad that Jesus did all my sins erase. Sing a brand new song, Amazing Grace, all day long. Christ Jesus paid a debt that I could never pay. He paid a debt he did not owe. I owed a debt I could not pay. Someone to wash my sins away. And now I sing a brand new song, Amazing Grace, all day long. Christ Jesus paid a debt that I could never pay. One day he's coming back for me to live with him eternally. Won't it be glory to see him on that day? I then will sing a brand new song, Amazing Grace, all day long. Christ Jesus paid a debt that I could never pay. He paid a debt he did not owe. I owed a debt I could not pay. I needed someone to wash my sins away. Now I sing
sing a brand new song. Amazing grace, all day long. Christ Jesus paid the debt that I could never pay.
My God, my God.
My God, my God, why have you forsaken me? Was the cry of the Savior as he hung upon that tree. My God, why have you forsaken me? Oh, the hell that Jesus suffered to rescue you and me. For he was pierced for our transgressions and crushed for our sins. He was punished and broken so we could be at peace. Abandoned and forsaken so we could be set free. The wrath of the Father was fully poured on him. My God, why have you forsaken me? Oh, the hell that Jesus suffered, I cannot fully see. My God, why have you forsaken me? When he who knew no sin became sin for me. He was pierced for our transgressions and crushed for our sin. He was punished and broken so we could be at peace. Abandoned and forsaken so we could be set free. The wrath of the Father was fully poured on him. My God, why have you forsaken me? Oh, the hell that Jesus suffered, I cannot fully see. My God, why have you forsaken me? When he who knew no sin became sin for me. He was pierced for our transgressions and crushed for our sin. He was punished and broken so we could be at peace. Abandoned and forsaken so we could be set free. Oh, the wrath of the Father was fully poured on him. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus, because he first loved me. Oh, how I love Jesus, Jesus, oh, how I love Jesus, because he first loved me.
We've been working our way through 1 John, and we're coming to these two verses that I want us to spend time on today. There's such a profound statement in this passage that changes the direction of individuals for eternity that I think is very important. 1 John 2:1, my little children, these things I write to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. And he himself is the propitiation, or the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the whole world. These two little verses have a tremendous amount of wealth within them, and we're going to try and break that down. I just wanted to quickly go over what we talked about last week, because of the seriousness of sin, the consequences of sin. We looked at sin's judgment. We looked at sin's power. We looked at sin's habits. We looked at sin's defilement. We looked at sin's disabling. And we looked at sin's deception. Now that was a mouthful. I know, actually, when I mixed this thing together, I realized I preached for 50 minutes. I probably won't do that today. I'll try not to anyway. But it's a vast subject, sin. And it is the devastating consequences of it have been felt, reverberate through the entire creation of God. The Bible says all of creation is groaning. And the reason why creation is groaning is because we have sinned, because mankind has rebelled against God and all of the consequences that come with it. And that's why we saw in 1 John him dealing with sin and the importance of it. We saw that God wanted us to know him. We want to be in fellowship with the Father, with his Son, Jesus Christ, in fellowship with the people of God. But 1 John 1:6 said, if we say we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. You cannot consistently walk in darkness. Now, the word walk is used here because it doesn't mean falling into sin occasionally. It means that's the pattern of your life. And it's a very scary thing when someone says, oh yeah, I'm saved, I'm going to heaven, but they're walking in darkness. You better take a good look, because you lie and you do not practice the truth. 1 John 1:8, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. We will discover, if you haven't already discovered, that even when you want to do good, sometimes you find this urge to go the wrong direction in your life. And we'll be looking at that on Wednesday nights for a little while now. We started, but we're going to be at it for a while on victory over sin because of the sin principle that is within you. And I just want to let you know it'll be there until you leave this world. There'll be a sin principle there, that urge to go in the wrong direction. But there's victory. There's victory, praise God. But it's not found in you. It's found in Jesus. And so you'll deceive yourself if you think, I've reached sinless perfection. I'm never going to sin again, because that's probably not true, unless you die just in the next 5 minutes from there. And so if you say you have no sin, you're self-deceived, because then you will not find Christ or depend upon Christ. You'll become proud and think, oh no, I've got this. You don't got this. Jesus has it. He always has it. And then the other one, if we say we have not sinned, well, then we're really in trouble, aren't we? We make him a liar and his word is not in us. If we say we have not sinned, sadly, there are some who think they have not sinned, especially those, of course, who don't even believe there's a God, so there is no sin. Do what you want. But we also discovered there was an answer for it in 1 John 1:7. We walk in the light as he is in the light. We have fellowship with one another. The blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. 1 John 1:9, we confess our sin. He's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. But it's only because of the blood of Jesus. It's only because of his death. And that's why when we come to this passage of Scripture, where he begins to explain things, John goes further.
And the reason why he goes further is because he challenges us. We need to know God. He challenges us in 1 John chapter 1. We need to walk in the light. He challenges us that even when we walk in the light, there are times when we do sin. We need to acknowledge that. We need to confess it. We need to get right with God. But then some people might think, oh, okay. As long as I keep on confessing, I can keep on sinning. Right? Let's get this, you know, okay. Well, I know this is wrong, but I'll do it now and I'll confess it later. Good plan, eh? Yeah. No, John says, hold on now, my little children, and I love that term. John was probably 90 years old and he had the right to call everybody his children at that point. But it's a term of endearment. You know, God is, it expresses the heart of God. God is full of passion and love for us. Matter of fact, it's interesting in this passage, and I'll get to that next week. The word love is mentioned in 1 John 48 times. Imagine, 48 times, and it's only a short little book. But we don't see the word love mentioned until we get later on in chapter 2, and I'll explain why next week. But it's pretty amazing when you stop and think about it. It's because certain things have to be in place or we don't even understand love. I couldn't help but share a little bit why. Because if we don't know what love is. The world doesn't understand what love really is because we have been so bamboozled by the devil and everybody else and our own deceptive hearts that we miss what love is. And so the world talks about love probably more than anything else, but it doesn't live it. So you need the foundations under, you need to understand what love truly is and who love really is. God is love. And as you begin to understand those foundations and you begin to understand the truth of God's word and the holiness that he calls you to, you begin to discover the depth of the love of God. So my little children, he says, these things I'm writing to you so that you may not sin. He wants them to understand, yes, there's provision for when you've gone astray. Thank God there is, or none of us would ever be saved. None of us could ever keep our salvation. We couldn't keep it anyways. God is who keeps it. But our failure does not mean that God is done with us. But it also, there's a deep challenge here. Don't sin. I write these things so that you don't sin. Not so that you can sin and confess, but that you may not sin. Now that tells me something. It means that sin ought not to be the norm in your life, but rather the exception. The exception. So don't tell me, oh yeah, I sin 25, 30, 50 times a day. If you do, then you're walking in darkness. It ought not to be the norm, but rather the exception. And when you become aware of sin, thank God, you can confess your sin. He is faithful and just to forgive you your sin. He'll cleanse you from all unrighteousness. Because God's challenge in the Word of God, as he who called you is holy, 1 Peter 1:15, you also be holy in all your conduct. Now that's a big, tall order. God says, I want you to be holy. But he gives the answer to it because it is written, be holy, for I am holy. Now you can think about it this way. Be holy, because I am holy. You be holy down there, because I'm holy up here. You could think about it that way, but rather think about it this way. Because God sent his son Jesus Christ to die for our sins, and God sent the Holy Spirit, God himself, isn't that what the Holy Spirit is? He's God himself, to come and live in you. Now when he says, be holy, for I am holy, because I have holiness for you. Because I live in you, and if you're a believer in Jesus Christ, I am your holiness. The Bible tells us very clearly, 1 Corinthians chapter 1, second last verse, can't remember the number, I'm bad for numbers, but the second last verse says that he is our holiness. Christ is our holiness. It's not, you got no holiness apart from him, but he is our holiness. So when he says, be holy for I am holy, praise God. That's the source of my holiness. It's God himself, not me. And praise the Lord that he calls you not to sin. Remember how destructive, how damaging sin was. We saw what it did to us, how it defiles you, how it disables you, how it deceives you, how it brings you under judgment, how it, Oh, it's just a nightmare. How many people are living in that nightmare? Most of planet Earth is. And God calls you out of the nightmare into his light and love. And so he says, my little children, these things write unto you that you sin not. But then he says, and if anyone sins, again, you can see that the sin is the exception, not the norm. Does that make sense? If anyone sins. So it's not like, oh, you're sinning all the time. No, if you do sin, we do have an advocate. One who comes alongside. That's what it means. It's from the word paraclete or paracletus, which is the means one who comes alongside. A divine helper. With the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. Now we get our word advocate. What does that mean in our modern day language? Usually if you think of an advocate, you think of what?
A lawyer.
Yeah. You have a lawyer. Why? Because what a lawyer does is when you're in trouble, he comes alongside of you, hopefully, really cares for you, hopefully. I might depend on the size of your paycheck or whatever. Really cares for you and goes to bat for you and says, I'm going to get you off. I'm going to get you through this. I'm going to look after you. Well, we have one who is our advocate, the Lord Jesus Christ. And in one sense, all of us need a lawyer, and you need a good one. If you're going to face the Almighty Judge, you need a real lawyer. And the only lawyer that will get you off is Jesus Christ. So, if anyone sins, we have an advocate, a helper, one who comes alongside with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. And this one here is not like the lawyers of our day. You know, I assure you, if you go looking for a lawyer, he's not going to say, I'll come, I'll move in with you, I'll stick with you. You're going to be the priority one in my life. Above everything else, I'm going to take care of you. And never mind the money. Right? But what does Jesus do? For both he who sanctifies and those who are being sanctified are all of one. Now, what is that saying? Jesus Christ is the one who sanctified means to be made holy, okay? For he, Jesus, who sanctifies, he's the one that makes us holy. We don't make ourselves holy, right? And those who are being sanctified, the ones who are being made holy, who's that? Us, okay? What are we? All of one. Jesus Christ has united himself to you. Do you get it? That he's come, so which reason? He's not ashamed to call them brothers. He's not ashamed to say, you're family now. I'm looking after you. It'd be a little bit different, surely, at least if you, you know, if you had a lawyer in the family, let's say, and you had trouble, you'd probably feel a little more assurance to go and talk to the lawyer in the family because you'd think, well, at least they care for me, unless you're feuding, and if they, you know, that he cares for me, so then I can say I can go to him and he's gonna look out to me, and he says I'm not ashamed to call you mine. Imagine Jesus says that. That's the one who wants to come alongside. I'm not ashamed of you. Now, sometimes we often feel ashamed of ourselves, right? And sometimes we feel a lot of shame before others too. But Jesus says, I'm not ashamed of you. I'm your family. I'm your older brother now, and I'm going to look after you. That's the advocate that we have. If anyone sins, we have an advocate. But remember, it's because he's dealing with the issue of sin. He's dealing with the issue of failure. But we discover, Hebrews 7:24 says, but he, Jesus, because he continues forever, has an unchangeable priesthood. And that means that in the Old Testament, high priests came and went, but not Jesus. He's unchangeable because he's God, because he continues forever, because he's risen from the dead. Therefore, he is also able to save to the uttermost those who come to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. That's what a lawyer does before a judge. He intercedes on your behalf. But now he says that he's able to save you to the uttermost. That's the kind of savior he is. That's the fullness of what he comes to do for us. It's not partway, it's not halfway, it's a complete salvation that he gives you, and it's for those who come to God through him. Have you come to God? Have you come to Jesus? If you've truly come to Jesus Christ, then you have someone who's always looking after you. Isn't that pretty plain here? And that he's not a failure at it either.
He does it perfectly. He's able to save to the uttermost or completely. Thank God for that. And in 1 John chapter 2, verse 2, now we come to the next section of this, just to confirm what we were saying here, that we have, my little children, I write these things that you don't sin, but if you do sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. And then it says, why he's the advocate? Why is he the lawyer that can help us? Why is it that we can have this blessed assurance? What's the foundation of it? Is it because I belong to a certain religion? Is it because I've worked really hard? Is it because I like to pray? Or is it because I try my best? Or I come from good stock? Is it because of these things? No. It is because of Jesus Christ. And it's because of what he has done, not what you have done. What you have done is messed up. What you have done is sinned. What he has done is come to deal with the issue. He himself, and here's that wonderful word that you learned when you were in grade primary, the propitiation. Okay, now it's a word that I don't know why they still, it's there, but I mean, the meaning of it is the atoning sacrifice or the price paid. Okay? He is the price paid for our sins. That's what the word means. He is the price paid. Not just he paid the price, but he is the price paid. There's a difference between that. You know, when you pay something, oh yeah, okay, I've got so much money, I'll give that to you, okay. But I've only given a part of myself, right? I've only given a certain amount. But Jesus Christ himself is the price paid. Now that's different, isn't it? That's complete. That's an absolute sacrifice. I think I told you that joke before, but you know, the pig and the hen that were walking down the road and they saw there was a ham and egg supper advertised, or breakfast, I don't care what it was. But anyway, you know, the hen says, oh, let's make a contribution. The pig says, that's okay for you. You just have to drop an egg. Me, I got to give my hams away. So there's such a thing as giving something for something, but Jesus is the price paid. He gave himself completely. It was he's the price paid. Unbelievable. That is why it can say, he who knew no sin became sin for us, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. And so when he says this, you have an advocate, you have someone who will be there on your behalf. Most of the world likes the idea of having somebody to help them. God's on my side. I want God on my side. If there's a God at all, I want him. Oh, me and God, we're good. We're good. We're good. We're good. If you go away from the cross, if you try to get to God without the cross, without the price paid, you don't have any hope. You don't have an advocate. You don't have a savior. You don't have any hope whatsoever. But thank God Jesus Christ has come. He is the atoning sacrifice. He is the price paid. He didn't just put something on the altar for a sacrifice. He put himself. He put himself there on the cross. Hebrews 10:12 says, but this man, Jesus, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins forever, that's himself, as we already saw, sat down at the right hand of God. One sacrifice for sins forever. A sufficient sacrifice. A price paid absolutely. Isaiah 53:4, surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities, our sins. The chastisement for our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. This is Jesus. This is the one. This is what happened to Jesus. We see it here. And no wonder in John 19:30, when Jesus had received the sour wine, when he was on the cross, and he cried, he said, it is finished. And bowing his head, he gave up his spirit. And you've heard me say it before, the Greek word is tetelestai, which means paid in full. It was the actual words that was put on a receipt when you bought something in the marketplace. At that time, if you wanted a receipt back, they wrote tetelestai on it. It is finished. In other words, it's paid. And that's exactly what Jesus said on the cross. What a statement that he could make. Paid in full, paid in full. Imagine how glorious is that, how awesome it is that he took your sin and my sin on the cross. Because all we like sheep have gone astray, Isaiah 53:6. We have turned every one to his own way, but the Lord has laid on him the iniquity or the sin of us all. Amazing. The Lord laid it on him. The Lord laid it on him. The Father laid it on the Son. Isn't that what it says? I'm not making this up. God the Father took his own Son and laid on him your sin. That's amazing. That is why we can have an advocate. That is why we can have someone. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him. It was the will of the Father to crush his Son. Now, I've heard some people argue and say, oh, that's awful. I don't want a God that would do that to his own Son. It was love that made him do this. It was love for you. If you don't want a God who doesn't crush his Son, then you don't want God. Because God crushed his Son so you wouldn't be crushed. He put him to grief. He put his own Son to grief. When his soul makes an offering for guilt. But it says he shall see his offspring. He shall prolong his days and the will of the Lord will prosper in his hand. And what it says there is that he will see his offspring. And the offspring of God are those who believe in him. He shall see his children. Jesus was willing to go to the cross. The Father was willing to put him on the cross. And it was for the sake of saving you and I so we could become the children of God. It's the only way you could. You have to come through the cross. 1 Corinthians 15:3 says, I delivered you first of all, which also I received. And of most importance is the connotation here. And some translations actually say it. This is of first importance that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. He was buried and he rose again on the third day according to the scriptures. It's the heart of the gospel. I was speaking to a Muslim man recently. And he said, oh, we believe in Jesus. Oh, yeah. But we don't believe he died. We don't see any point in that. We don't believe he died and rose again. We believe God just took him up to heaven. We don't need the cross. Then you don't understand. And I said to him, listen. I said, How do you hope to be saved? Well, Allah is merciful. Allah is merciful. Allah is merciful. Okay. I said, is he just? Yes. He's just too. I said, if he's just, then he must punish sin. Sin has to be punished. Justice must be met. The scales have to balance, or God cannot be God. The only way that justice and mercy can meet, and the only place where justice and mercy is met, is at the cross. At the cross. As one hymn writer said, it's where wrath, the wrath of God for sin, and mercy meet. The mercy of God meets God's wrath and nullifies it completely. The only way. That is why Jesus could clearly say, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. You cannot bypass the cross. And I fear that many so-called evangelical churches today have moved away from the cross, have moved away from the price paid, moved away from the this is the only pathway in through the cross. And I fear that instead, oh, God loves you all. Everybody just come and let's have a love party. We'll all just worship, 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 worship. But no cross, no salvation, no life. The only way up is the way down. And that is to humble ourselves and come. And if it's of first importance, it's of first importance. You can't leave it out. And sadly, there are some who are trying to say, oh, you know, Christ's death on the cross was an example of his love.
And not long ago, I heard that someone who was proclaiming to be a believer and had once actually preached the gospel is now saying, Christ, everybody's already saved. That's not true. If that was true, then Christ wasted his time. If that was true, then do sin. Do whatever you want. You're going to heaven anyway. Not true. Romans 6:23 makes it clear the wages of sin is what? Death. To be cut off. Cut off from God. Cut off from others. Cut off. When Adam and Eve sinned in the garden, they were cut off from God. The relationship was broken. They were broken in their relationship with others. And that death is carried on. They did physically die. They spiritually died then. And then, of course, there's actually the second death, which is to be cast into a lake of fire. The Bible says this. But the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. The wages of sin, you earned your place in hell. You all have. God says you don't have to earn your place in heaven. Good thing. Instead, he says it's a gift. The gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. And so, while the wages of sin is death, Christ came and he died. He died physically. Ultimate suffering. It has been well declared that no one can suffer any worse than someone being crucified because of the way that it is done. And on top of everything else, from the whipping and the beating and the ripping and the tearing, he suffered ultimately, physically. But he also died spiritually. There was a spiritual death that happened there. How? What happened there? Listen to it. Matthew 27:46, about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. That is the translation of it. My God, why have you forsaken me? He was cut off from the Father. And that is ultimate suffering. You could watch the Passion and you could see all that does is portray the physical sufferings of Jesus, but it doesn't portray the spiritual suffering of Jesus, the mental, the emotional suffering of Jesus, as he was cut off from the Father, where he and the Father were always one in every way for all eternity. The fabric of that was ripped at the cross, and the agony of that would have been incredible to behold. We can't really see it, but we can hear it from God's Word. And if you've been a Christian any length of time, if in a moment the presence of God, which many of us have taken for granted, if it was ripped away from you, you would scream. All the ugliness of what you are without him would come rushing in. And you would scream. You would say, you would be horrified. You would realize how much of a blessing Jesus really is. And what he has done in uniting us with him. But he and the Father were always united. They were always perfect. Everything was always one. There was never a cloud between Jesus and the Father. But now, the Father forsakes the Son. The wrath of God was poured out on him. So it wasn't poured out on you. 1 Peter 2:24. He himself bore our sins in his own body on the tree. He bore our sins in his own body in the tree, that we, having died to sins, might live for righteousness, by whose stripes you are healed. By his suffering, you are healed. Praise God. He bore your sins so that we could die to sin and live to righteousness. There's a purpose in it all. It's so that we might live a holy life, and we'll get to that as we go through the rest of 1 John. Now, I'm just going to close with this last part of 1 John 2:2. He himself is the propitiation, or the atoning sacrifice, price paid for our sins, but not for ours only, but also for the whole world. What does that mean? Well, there's been some debates between theologians on this verse. But let me say this. I want you to think about it this way. Let's suppose in the entire world, all the human race committed 10 sins. Now, that's a slight underestimate.
of the reality, but I'm doing it for just for illustration point, okay? Because I couldn't count the amount of sin that has been generated by the human race, let alone the amount of sin has been generated from Pierre Chesson. But let's just say there's 10. And Jesus died for those sins, for the 10 sins, okay? But let's say somehow, this is only theoretical, okay? Let's say, oops, Pierre committed 11. Oh, no. Jesus has to go back up on the cross to get rid of the 11th one. Now, does he? Why? What Jesus did on the cross, he suffered the ultimate for sin. There's nothing beyond the ultimate. Do you get what I'm saying? There's not like another level that he needed to do to die for sins. He suffered the ultimate punishment completely in every way so that it is sufficient for all. You understand? It's sufficient for the entire world. What he did on the cross is enough for the entire world. It's not like, oh, 7 more people come in here. Now you're going to have to suffer some more. No, it's sufficient for all, but it is only efficient for those who believe. Okay? And this is a glorious statement because it means it's available. And if you're listening to this and you're not a Christian yet, you have not yet trusted Christ as your personal Savior, it's available for you. I can say that because the Bible says to preach the gospel to every creature. It's available to you, but it will not be yours unless you repent and believe. It's efficient only for those who come. And so that leaves us with a challenge here. I think John was writing this to make it clear. Listen, it's just not for a few folks here, for us, the ones that are saved now, but it's for many, 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 many more. Anyone, for whosoever will may come. Whosoever will may come. It's efficient for those who believe. And when I say that, I can tell you a wealth of scripture that says that without faith it's impossible to please God. I can tell you that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son that whoever believes in him may not perish but have eternal life. And I can challenge you and I want to challenge every one of us to understand that the grace of God is efficient to those who put their faith in Jesus Christ. The atoning sacrifice has been accomplished. It doesn't have to be done again and again and again. One sacrifice for sins forever. It is all done. It is enough. It is more than enough. And it's not like he runs out of grace or runs out of mercy. The question is what will you do with Jesus? Will you come? Will you trust in him? Will you receive all that he has through Christ? So as John writes these things, he challenges people. And he wants them to know that Jesus Christ's sacrifice is pretty awesome. Wouldn't you say? It's pretty full, and it's for anyone who's willing to come. Amen. Oh, let me challenge you to do just that. Come to Jesus and discover his goodness. Let's sing a song in closing. Jesus paid it all. Stand and sing.
I hear the Savior say, thy strength in thee is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray, find in thee thy all in all. Jesus paid it all through him my own. Sin has left a crimson stain.
Side of us, Lord. Thank you. You would hold us. You would keep us. You would watch over us. You would intercede for us because you've done the greatest thing already. You died for us. You became sin for us. You paid the price. You were the price. Blessed be your name, Lord. Thank you that you were forsaken so we wouldn't. I worship you. We worship you. And we pray that many more would come. We thank you there's room at the cross. Though millions have come, there's still room for one. There's room at the cross for you. Oh, Jesus, may many come, Lord. May many come, Lord, from Cheticamp, from Cape Breton. There's not enough, Lord. May many come and repent and trust in Jesus. And they will be able to declare the price is paid. And we give you all the glory in Jesus' name. Amen.